So hi everybody, thanks for being here. I prepared for you very simple examples to tell you more about the hardware, and then I will make a very short demo about the. Well, I will talk very briefly about the OpenMP and the OpenACK version that we use at CSS. But let's start with the CPU. Most of the time, people ask what kind of CPU we have, and there are many different ways to do that, to know that. Ah, okay. So before I start, I will. So anyone doesn't know the module command? What the module command is? It's explained on the sheet, but basically it's a tool that will take care of switching from one programming environment to the other. It will take care of loading the right compiler and also all the different libraries that are installed by Cray and also installed by us. So if you do a module list, you will see the. Well, actually, I need to start from scratch. So if you do a module list, you will see the. The list of loaded module files, and the important thing is here. So by default, we load the Cray compiler, which is called CC, and on the system we have four compilers available. So we have the Cray compiler, CC, the GNU compiler, the Intel compiler, and the PGI compiler. But for that course, and I will explain why later, we will use only the Cray and the PGI compiler because it's the only compiler that supports OpenMP4 and OpenACC. Well, actually, there is a beta version of the GNU compiler that supports OpenACC, but it's still not very usable. So we'll stick with the Cray and the CC compiler, the Cray and PGI compiler. So what else? I guess it's important to see that the Cray libsci library is loaded by default. But in our case, because we want to use the GPU, we need to load a module that is called the Cray PAXL NVIDIA 60, which is so if you do module show, you will see that module file will set the compilation node for the GPU, and it will load actually two module files. So by loading that module file, I will load the CUDA toolkit and also the accelerated version of the Cray scientific library. Okay, so before I show you how to use the GPU, I will show you how to get some basic information about the type of CPU that we have. So, because it's a Cray system, you have to remember that there are different types of nodes. So you have the login node, which is Ella, that we use to access CSS. And then you have another type of login node, which I call the compilation node, which is the node where we are, and that we use for compilation and submitting jobs. And then you have the compute node, which is very different from the compilation node because it has a GPU actually. And the only way to access that compute node is to use a slurm command called srun. And for example, if I do this because I want to know what the type of CPU that I have on my node, you will see here. Okay, I have Intel CPU, and it means it's a, in that case, it's a Haswell CPU, and it has 10 cores, and the frequency is 2.3 gigahertz. But actually, if I do the same on the compute node, so I will call the srun command, but before I do that, because of the course, we reserved around 30 nodes for you, so you don't have to wait in the queue, because if you look, there are many, many jobs running right now, and if we, every time you want to submit a job, you have to wait 15 or 30 minutes or more, it's not very practical. So we have a reservation, and actually, it's explained on the sheet, if you want to run a job, you have to give the name of the reservation as an argument and also the name of the account, so you are able to use the nodes. So in theory, you should write something like this. And which is a bit long, I agree. So that's why for the exercise, it's better if you modify your bash RC, and then at the end you will just set these three variables, so then it will be easier to submit jobs. And actually you can find a script inside the exercise that will do exactly that. Okay, so before I show you the how to run the job, so we are using Slurm to run jobs on the compute node. It's a very popular job scheduler. And if you want to know more information about the system, of course we have more than one system at CSCS, but the main and the biggest production system at CSCS, it's the Cray system, and it's PSTained. And I guess the important thing to say is that actually we have two types of compute nodes, but for the course, of course, we are going to use only the GPU nodes, but we also have some nodes who don't have GPUs and have only, so the GPU nodes have an Haswell CPU plus the Pascal GPU, but we also have nodes which have two Broadwell CPUs, which are more advanced or more modern CPUs. Okay, and then if you really want to know more, you can always click on that link and go to the user documentation, which is very detailed. Okay, I will go back to this later. Okay, so let's say that you know nothing about the Cray system and you want to know first what kind of CPU are, especially if you want to use OpenMP, I guess you need to know how many cores are on the node. Then it will, you can choose how many OpenMP threads you can run based on the number of cores. So I guess, an easy way to do that is to look inside the slash proc CPU info file. And here, because I'm not calling srun, I'm just looking at the compilation node. So here I see that I have 20. It's telling me that I have 20 cores. Actually, it's not 20, it's 10, because... Oh, yes, sorry. That's an alias. So it's telling me that I have 20, but because of hyperthreading, actually, I have only 10 physical cores. And in HPC, I think it's very rare for people to use hyperthreading, unless you are on a many-core architecture, but we are not so. So If I do the same, so here I want to run one task for the duration of 1 minute because it's a very short, and I want to run on the GPU part of the system, and I want to see what kind of CPU I have. And for example, you will see, okay, I have to wait. So if I count, I should find 24, but because of hyperthreading, it's 12 physical core on the compute node. Okay, and then same thing for if I want to know how much memory I have on the node, it's very easy. You just read the /proc/ meminfo, and you will see that you get more or less 64 gigabytes per compute node. So what else? So you could use the PAPI command. So if you load the PAPI module file, it will tell you a little bit more about the CPU. So we are still having as well CPU, but the important part here is that we have 12 physical cores on the compute node. We have only one socket because each compute node has two sockets made of one CPU and one GPU. And then if you use hyperthreading, then you multiply by two and gives you 24. So I always have an issue because I never remember what that number means. So there's a nice utility, it's called Liquid. And actually it will translate that number into a marketing brand name. So I know, I'm sure I'm on a Haswell CPU. And then you get the same kind of information. You have only one socket and 12 cores per socket.
I'm sorry, what was that again?
That was called Liquid Topology. So actually, if you have to load it, it's not loaded by default. So you have to load the module file first and then you run it. You run it like that. I run PAPI Ovel. Okay, it's okay. You don't have it. It's only in my directory. So you load the PAPI module file and then you run PAPI Ovel with srun, and then you get this. PAPI Ovel, yeah. Okay. So there is another module file, which is called, okay, it's a bit small, but it's called hwlock, which is pre-installed that you can load. And if you run LS topo like this, I know it's a bit small, but I want to show you the. So if you're on LS topo, you will get that view of the CPU, which is actually very nice, especially if you want to use affinity or CPU binding. Because here you see that you have 12 cores, which are numbered in a weird way, actually, the physical core, because you have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then it jumps directly to 8. So I don't know, core 6 and 7 are used for the system, but not for you. But in total, you have 12 cores, and then you can see that each core has two hyperthreads. So you have for physical core 0, you have hyperthread 0, number 0, and number 12. But most of the time, you will use only one hyperthread, so basically, you don't have to worry. It's very simple because we have only one CPU or only one socket, so. LS topo, yeah. Yeah, and the module is called HWLock. It's this one. You have to do module load, this one. Like that? Really? Okay. For me, okay. Can you try this? Do a module use, and then it should appear in the list. No? Okay. I will check with you. Okay, so now we know a little bit more about the CPU, but what about the GPU? So you don't have, I did not give you the source code here because I was not allowed by NVIDIA to share the include files because they are under copyright. But actually, it's very easy to download. When you download the CUDA toolkit from the NVIDIA website, it comes with a very large directory with a lot of different samples. And my example is just based on the device query sample. So it will be very easy to reproduce what I will show you. So, okay, so now I want to, in that case, I have a CUDA code that I use all the time to know more about the GPU. So the first thing that you need to do if you want to compile the CUDA code is to switch to the GPU programming environment. So an easy way to do that is to module swap. From Cray to GNU. And if you do a module list, you see that now the GNU module file is loaded. But I also need the CUDA toolkit. So I will load the CUDA toolkit. And you see that now it's here. I'm using CUDA version 8.0, which is the minimum version that you need to be able to use the Pascal GPU. And then I just compile my code. So in that case, I will not run anything on the GPU. I will just query some informations. It's a simple hello world. So,
where is this code?
I can't share the code because it's NVIDIA. But I can show you how to do it if you want.
Share it with me.
So, a nice command if you want to know what's happening. Why my job is not starting. You can use the sq command. So in that case, I'm the only one running. Okay, and my job just finished to run. So if you look, okay, so it's telling me that we have a Pascal GPU, good. The version of the driver is compatible with CUDA 8, so that's also good. The compute capability is 6.0. We have a lot of cores. The frequency of the core is rather slow compared to a CPU. And if you do the math, then you will find, if you multiply everything here, you will find out that the theoretical peak performance of the GPU is around 4 teraflop. And then you can get more information about the number of blocks, threads, gang. So basically, when you get a new GPU and then you don't know anything about the GPU, I think the important part is to check the compute capability, because that's a compilation flag that you will give when you compile the code. Yeah, that's why I put NVCC compile for the 6.0. And also the version of the CUDA driver, because that could vary between systems. Okay. So I guess the important point here is to show that depending on your hardware, you will be limited on the compute capability. So you will have to be careful. If you try to compile a code using the 6.0 on a Kepler GPU, which is the previous generation, NVCC will fail, because at that time the 6.0 capability didn't exist. And you see that the next generation, the Volta GPU, will be based on the CUDA 9. So you have to be careful that if you use a version of the CUDA toolkit, be sure that it corresponds to the GPU hardware that you have. Okay, so let's move to the interesting part. So here I have a very simple C++ code. And basically what it does, it just prints the, because depending on the compiler, depending on the PGI compiler or the Cray compiler, you will get a different level of support for OpenACC and OpenMP. So what I'm doing here, I'm just printing the OpenMP version and also the OpenACC version. So if you look, for example, so that's how I compile the code. And actually, you should have the code in your home dir. So this is how to compile the code with the Cray compiler. And don't forget to load the CUDA toolkit, otherwise you won't get the information about OpenACC. And if you run it, then you will see that for the Cray compiler, the most recent version of OpenMP that we get is this one, and for OpenACC is this one. And same thing for PGI. So PGI, it's a bit... Okay, for PGI, you have to load... You have to move from the Cray compiler to the PGI compiler. But because the latest version of the PGI compiler, which is not the default on Daint, has more OpenACC features, you need to execute these different commands. Yeah, for the example, it should be enough. You should not have to do that, but in case you want to try the latest version of the PGI compiler, then you should do that.
So before, I thought we were told that only Cray and PGI
No, because okay, I will finish with that question actually. I switched to GNU because I wanted to show you a CUDA example. But for OpenACC or OpenMP, it's only CC or only PGI for the moment. So I have a summary actually here. Okay, so if you go to the OpenACC website, you will find all the specs, and you will see that the latest version is OpenACC 2.5, and it was released almost 2 years ago, 2015. And same thing for the accelerated version of OpenMP, which is OpenMP 4.5, was also released 2 years ago. But there's always a delay between the specification and the time that it takes for the compiler team to implement the support. So I think the important part here is to see that if you use the PGI compiler, you will see that they support at least the latest version, supports the latest version of OpenACC, which is good. But they don't use the latest version of OpenMP for GPUs. On the other hand, the Cray compiler here doesn't stop supporting OpenACC up to version 2.0, but they support the latest version of OpenMP. So you see that different compilers have different priorities. And then GNU, they support OpenMP, but it's not officially released yet, right? And of course, Intel, because of their many core architecture, they don't support the GPUs. But they support OpenMP. I'm not sure about OpenACC on the KNL.
No.
So it's only OpenMP with Intel. So yes, that version, yes. But it doesn't, it's a partial support. It doesn't support the kernel directive, for example, which is a big part of OpenA. I'm confused now. It's only a partial support. So it's limited. So if you, actually, the only thing I'm giving you is the Hello World example, this one. And this one will give you the version. And then you can, then you know, right? Just by running the code. Yeah, I can put that. I can add it to the repo. So I have 5 more minutes left, so I would like to try to do a short demo, unless you have any questions. No. Okay, so you should be able to run. Okay, so here I just want to show you a very simple CUDA example, but it will be the same with OpenACC or OpenMP. I just want to show you because Vasily said this morning that when you use the GPU, you should really think in terms of massive number of threads, and I just will show you with a very simple example that even a very small GPU CUDA test needs is spawning a lot of CUDA threads. So this is a debugger. I'm not going to explain what it is, but it's a nice way to see what's happening on the GPU. Okay, so it's a simple code that is calling that function here, compute GPU. So I am in a C code, and then if I jump to the CUDA code, you see my function, compute GPU, that is actually calling the CUDA kernel, which is called simple kernel. And actually the kernel is here. So what I want to show you is that with that tool, actually, we can control the execution of the job and see what's happening on the GPU. So here I put a breakpoint. So I told to stop here, and now I want to continue step by step. And here you see that there is a new menu showing that now I am on the GPU, which is confirmed here because, okay, it's telling me that I am on the Pascal. And actually, for a very simple test, it's already using more than 100,000 threads, which is quite amazing. And of course, you can navigate between the threads if you want. That's a different story. But okay, my point is that if you want to use a GPU, you have to think parallel. Voilà. I think that's all I had to say. And of course, tomorrow you will have more exercise, so I hope it will be a little bit more clear for you. Any questions? No? So I guess it's lunchtime. Thank you. So it's in the course account.
Yeah.
So that's what, okay, wait, that's a good question actually. Tomorrow, yeah? Or
yeah,
tomorrow we'll, you will have to clone this and you will get all the exercise.
Meanwhile, I can put some of the outputs that you have.
Yeah, I can update that. So yeah, you can already clone the repo if you want. But if you are in the course account, you should already have this one. Yeah, it's already there. Yeah. I copied in the course. Yeah, we do. Doesn't? Okay, so I will come to you.
Do you have these directories for you in your course
account? Like, what's your course account?
Course 07.
because I put my key, so. It's in bin, right? So the only thing you have is this one, but you need to compile and run. Yeah. So, yeah, that's. This one.
To show it tomorrow, but probably yes, I will. I have to do it today. Sorry,
is it maybe possible to send the link to the GitHub?
Yeah, sure. I haven't uploaded any slides yet, so as soon as the course goes on, I will upload the.